So you can say, well, it talked about kernel design at the heart or the center or core of it. What really goes into it? What is included in the trusted computing base when it is done using the security kernel kind of an approach? So we said, well, in last one, we're saying everything that is necessary for the mechanisms that are necessary for correct enforcement of security policies we want to have in the system should go there. We know that resources are implemented using physical resources we have. So any I/O that's necessary to access your physical resources, primitive I/O has to be handled in there, which includes clocks, interrupt handling, at least capturing the interrupt and being able to directly access the hardware resources with whatever capabilities that are necessary for it. In memory, for example, we said we have TLBs for speeding up the address translation process and things like that. So who can manipulate those controls? What part of memory somebody can use? So that kind of stuff, if you're doing mandatory access control, then there's label checking, or that the model is going to rely on notion of labels and making sure secret information doesn't flow into an object that is unclassified and things like that. So that's part of your security policy, and the correct enforcement, of course, has to be implemented by the security kernel and direct access to hardware resources and their manipulation and support for these various models for access control we have has to be in that. The other thing we did is sort of virtualization. One way we get sort of a complete mediation and you can bypass it is that untrusted code has handles for virtual resources, unless we're talking about capability-based systems. So this virtualization or putting this mechanism going from virtual to physical resources helps us isolate the hardware from untrusted code, also allows us to do this separation